In Tucson, Arizona, Aurora, Colorado, Newtown, Connecticut, President Obama and gun control advocates called for a ban on assault weapons. But is it really the guns that are the problem? Mental health professionals have said that in all these cases, the shooters were on some kind of prescription medication. My next guest says it just might be the pills that are the problem. Joining me now, psychiatrist and author of Medication Madness, The Role of Psychiatric Drugs in Cases of Violence, Suicide, and Crime, Dr. Peter Breggin. And, Doctor, I love your message, and that's why I asked you to come on the show, because I think you have touched on something that is fascinating to me, is the fact that there are these psychotic drugs out there, and well, give the audience your opinion about them. I've heard you talk about this before.
Well, there's no doubt that psychiatric drugs can cause violence. And the most widely used ones, including particularly the antidepressants, the newer ones like Prozac and Paxil and Celexa, and also the benzodiazepines, the tranquilizers like Xanax and Klonopin, and then also the stimulant drugs we give to children. All of them have a significant association with violence. If you take a look at all the reports to the FDA, about drug violence, all the drugs that we use. Most of them, the vast majority, have no association with violence. And then those three groups I just mentioned, the psychiatric drugs, have many, many more times the number of reports of violence. So it's clearly
right,
established.
But you have somebody that comes to you and they are mentally ill. What do you do? Because a lot of doctors will just, you know, get out the old prescription pad and write a prescription. I've heard you talk about the fact that you've been doing this for decades and that you have cured a lot of mental illnesses with zero drugs.
Well, I don't think in terms of curing mental illnesses, Tom, as much as I think of helping people overcome their problems, helping people overcome their anguish, their pain, their anger, their suffering. And in my experience, and I think this is the absolute truth, what really helps people is a good, solid, caring relationship with somebody. And a therapist or psychiatrist, I'm a psychiatrist, who says, in effect, you can take charge of your life. You can be responsible for your life. You can learn how to handle your emotions. You can learn to live by better values. But that's not the current approach in psychiatry. You'll hear nothing in psychiatry about taking charge of your life, taking responsibility, or living by values. Instead, psychiatry turns people into machines and says, you have a biochemical imbalance, which is untrue. We've got a drug that can cure the biochemical imbalance, which is untrue. And those things make people feel more helpless and more out of control. So I think we need to get back to good, solid human relationship as a way of helping people.
Are you persona non grata at the Psychiatric Association meetings?
Well, I suppose I might even be subject to violence since we're talking about that. Yes, psychiatry is just a handmaiden now of the pharmaceutical industry. If you go to one of the big psychiatric meetings, it's going to a drug company carnival. They pay for everything. Psychiatry, our journals are paid for by the drug companies. Our meetings are paid for by the drug companies. And we make a lot of money by doing 10-minute med checks. You do a lot more financially that way than by sitting and talking with somebody. Psychiatry has lost its way, and I do think that the shootings really very much involve psychiatric drugs. I was an expert in cases surrounding Eric Harris from Columbine. I got to really look at his medical records, and you can see him deteriorating while taking an antidepressant, Luvox, and he had it in his bloodstream when he committed the violence.
Well, beyond the common thread of, you know, a lot of people say, well, the shootings, the guns have been the common thread. You're talking about, yeah, but there's also psychotic drugs are a common thread. I have a man I used to work with, sadly. I mean, father of the year, great guy, smart guy, but I didn't know he suffered from depression. They changed some medication on him. He went home and he stabbed to death his two little daughters. And he says to this day, he's in prison in North Carolina, he says it was because of the fact that the drugs made him do it. I never heard that argument before, but that seems to be yours.
Oh, well, there's no question about it. I've been involved in a case where a man on his second day of Paxil drowned his two children in a bathtub and drowned himself. There's a lot of cases like this. A woman who murdered one of her children and tried to murder another one on Zoloft. So this, which is an antidepressant. So there's no lack of cases about this, and I've looked at them in depth in Medication Madness, Tom. I have 50 cases where I've seen the medical records and interviewed people if they were alive, interviewed families where suicide and violence was a major theme. Yeah. So these are very serious problems.
Well, I'm just glad you're talking out about it. I'm glad you're speaking out about this. I wanted to give you the forum here to do it on this program, too, because I think your message is worth listening to, and a lot of people don't hear it. So, Dr. Peter Breggin, thank you so much. Appreciate your time.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you.
It has happened all too often. A troubled teenager gets his hand on a weapon, and lives are changed forever. But why? On the Record investigates, and as Fox's Douglas Kennedy found out, the trail can often lead right to the medicine chest.
2 years ago, 16-year-old Corey Badsgard took a rifle to his high school and held 23 classmates hostage.
Describe around that time how you were feeling.
In the morning, I didn't feel like going to school. I felt sick, didn't feel like really, like I could get up very well. And so I went back to bed, and next thing I remember, I'm in juvie in the detention center where I used to live.
Just one more apparently unexplainable violent outburst at school. Unexplainable to everyone but Corey's dad.
So in your mind, there's no doubt what happened here?
And no doubt that the medication did this. I mean, he had amnesia, hallucinations earlier, abnormal dreams, which are all side effects of the medication.
That morning, Corey was on a mix of antidepressants prescribed for what doctors called situational depression. His father says the pills turned Corey from a sensitive teenage boy to a volatile marauder, susceptible to blind rage.
He was never a violent kid. I mean, he's always been a good kid, loved us, hugged us all. He's never watched violent videos, and until medication, he started, after that, then we realized that he was having aggression problems and, was out of character.
At Fox News, we found the Badsgard story with antidepressants compelling, so we investigated further. We found a disturbing number of recent school shooters were either on medication or were experiencing withdrawal.
The list includes 15-year-old Kip Kinkle withdrawing from Prozac when he shot 22 classmates, killing two, after murdering his mother and stepfather at his home in Springfield, Oregon. 14-year-old Elizabeth Bush on Prozac when she blasted away at fellow students in Williamsport, Pennsylvania, wounding one. 18-year-old Jason Hoffman on Effexor and Celexa when he opened fire at his California high school, wounding five. 15-year-old Sean Cooper on a mix of antidepressants when he shot students in Idaho. 15-year-old TJ Solomon, also on a mix of antidepressants, when he aimed his shotgun at classmates in Conyers, Georgia, wounding six. And 17-year-old Eric Harris, on Luvox, when he and partner Dylan Klebold killed 12 classmates and a teacher in the bloodiest school massacre yet, Columbine.
One of the things that in the past we have known about depression is that it very, very rarely leads to violence. It's only been since the advent of these new SSRI drugs that we have murderers, sometimes even mass murderers, taking antidepressant drugs.
Here's some important safety information you should be aware of. Call your doctor if you have unusual changes in mood, behavior, or thoughts of suicide. Antidepressants can increase these in children, teens, and young adults. Call your doctor if you develop fever, stiff muscles, and confusion, as these may be signs of a life-threatening reaction.